Hi, welcome to Rainbow Space Magic Con 3.0. This is the publishing side of things panel. I'm Gillian St. Kevern. I am going to be moderating today's this panel. And we have just two incredible panelists to talk to. I cannot believe what Steve and Joel have accomplished between them. So I'm going to get them to introduce themselves, and then we will jump right in. So Steve, please tell us, please introduce yourself and tell us your a little bit about your experience in publishing.
Thank you. My name is Steve Berman. And I've worked in publishing for many, many years. Back in 2001, I started Lethe Press, which at this point is the oldest LGBT plus press specializing in queer speculative fiction. I'm also a writer myself and an editor. And by the way, Lethe Press does do audiobooks, but mostly we're known for print. And I love talking all things writing and publishing.
Yeah, so Steve's experience also includes a stint working in a gay bookstore. So he really has the whole plethora of publishing just like in one handsome package. And I'm super excited to talk to Joel because I've been friends on Facebook with Joel for many years. But this is the first time we've spoken in person. So this is a treat for me.
I had no idea you were from New Zealand. I had no idea.
No way. So, yeah, welcome, Joel. Please introduce yourself.
Awesome. It's so nice to be here. Thank you, guys. I'm Joel. I record LGBTQ plus material as Joel Leslie. I also record other material as Joel Froomkin. My actual name is Joel Leslie Froomkin, so I just separate the two brands that way. I've recorded about 450 audiobooks, many of them with indie authors, and guiding them through, introducing them to, bringing them to, or being found by them through sites like ACX, obviously, and dealing with that part of the process from the publishing side of audiobooks, indie titles. And I've worked with almost all of the major publishers in what they call the big five publishers in the audiobook industry, as well as many other actual audiobook publishers and traditional print publishers that do their own audio. I've been lucky enough to win 11 Audiophile Earphones Awards, which Audiophile is sort of the publishers, it's the audiobook sort of critical tome. I've also won a SOVAS award, which is Society of Voice Arts, three independent audiobook awards. So I've been very lucky, and I've had the chance to work with some absolutely incredible authors, and I'm really excited to be here today. So yay, thank you.
Oh, we are excited to have both of you. Joel, before we get started, is the background we see behind you, is this your recording studio?
Yeah, this is my booth. This is my little cave that I work in. There's Disney Funkos at the back on two shelves, because I'm a Disney addict. We live 14 minutes from Disney World. And yeah, this is my booth. This is where I spend about 7 to 8 hours of my day every day. So yeah.
That is awesome. Okay. So I'm going to kick the panel off with a question, but I want to remind our audience, please feel free to throw your own questions into the chat at any time. I've got a few written down, but we want this to be as interactive as possible and as useful for you. I just realized I haven't introduced myself. I'm Gillian St. Kevern. As Joel pointed out, I'm a New Zealand author of LGBTQ plus fantasy that confounds expectations. I put that in because basically my characters surprise me. And if I'm surprised, then I figure the reader has no idea. So I'm kind of here as the, you know, in movies where there's a character that's sort of the audience identification character that is their gateway into the film. I'm just here to be your stand-in, ask your questions, and try and get the most out of our time with Joel and Steve. So the first question I have is, what motivated you to get into the publishing and audiobook industry? And we'll start with Steve.
Oh gosh, so I was working for a small religious publisher at the time, and I had just learned about print-on-demand technology, and I thought, you know, this would be really interesting as a way to bring back some books that I always wanted on my bookshelf, but were hard to find because they were out of print. And so I started doing that. And originally it was more for folklore and mythology, but I discovered there was a whole number of gay books out of print. And then quickly that became, let me do current books. And in fact, I rarely do books that are out of print anymore because there's just so much exciting material now to bring out to people and to share with people. So
I am astounded. I've just realized why you're called Lethe Press. That yes. Makes so much sense now.
Yes.
Okay, so Joel, what motivated you to get into the audiobook industry?
It's a long, circuitous story, but I'll try and make it short. I had been in the professional theater industry for many, many, many years, and my husband and I had been started a theater company in Indiana. We went to Indiana not because we knew anyone there or knew anything about Indiana, but because we fell in love with a building that was there that was a 100-year-old vaudeville house that we wanted to convert into a musical theater space, which over 10 years we did. And by that time, unfortunately, when we got to that sort of, you know, the crux of what we were trying to do, we realized that A, Indiana was not an easy place for two gay guys to live, especially not for two gay guys who were trying to do musical theater, and that where we were, there are places in Indiana it would have worked, but where we were, there simply wasn't the audience or the support that we needed. And we kind of were like, oh shit, what do we do? And a friend of mine who I've known since I was about 16, her name is Beverly Crick. She's a very successful audiobook narrator in her own right, said to me, why don't you do this? And both she and I have this weird skill set because we both grew up in Bermuda, which is a UK Commonwealth. And therefore, I have American parents. And when I went to college, this accent is kind of learned, this standardized American accent. But when I was growing up, only my parents were the only American sounds around me. Everyone else was British. And from, because they were all expats, a wide range of British sounds. So I came to this with this weird skill set of being able to do a bunch of British accents authentically, as well as an American accent. And I went on to ACX, which is kind of what they call the, you know, it's sort of the Tinder of the audiobook world, where you can match up with indie authors. And within 3 months, I was doing it full time. I just got very lucky and I was very busy very quickly. And then that branched out into publisher work. And, you know, I've been very successful and really fortunate with the journey.
Wow. I am really, I don't know if the amused is the right word, but I also grew up living overseas in an expat community, and it had the opposite effect on me. I am accent blind. Ha. I cannot identify accents, and I end up, I have this weird kind of mutant accent that confuses a lot of people. During Joel's question, I had to get up and let a dog out of a room. I will probably have to do this a lot during our panel. I apologize. I'm a house sitter. I got called in at the last minute, and
that's
this
fine.
Is a puppy. I knew that Joel wouldn't mind. But yes, please bear with me. I will try to keep the puppy interruptions to a minimum. So what are the biggest changes you've seen in your time in publishing and audio production? I'm excited to ask this question because both Joel and Steve have like decades of experience under their belt. Steve, let's start with you.
I mean, so the drawn out thing is when I started my press, we were at the tail end of the gay bookstore. There are some still exist. In fact, the one that I worked at is, you know, Giovanni's Room in Philadelphia is still there. And every so often new ones pop up, but it changed. Primarily, gay bookstores were the means for gay men and women to find out what books were out. There wasn't originally there was no Amazon for men and women to go to, and so they would learn all the books, and they would also talk with the people in the store who would give them recommendations. And there were, where else would you go to find out which books are good or if you like certain things? And so that by the end of the 20th century and the start of the 21st definitely changed, because now I didn't have to go to a large metropolitan or gay resort to find out about where gay books were, and you had Amazon. And the other thing though was gay newspapers were dying, so your review sites were less. Nowadays, most people buy their gay books invariably through Amazon. And so, which has its own problems and own benefits. I if I'm closeted, I can get my books in a wrap package and I don't have to worry about my mailman seeing what I'm getting. The other new trend is, of course, we're seeing a larger amount of transgender fiction that is being released and embraced, especially by librarians. One of my best-selling titles is a transgender queer spec fic book by Gillian K. Jarboe. Everyone on the Moon is Essential Personnel. It won a Lambda Literary Award. And so it's really exciting to see a new generation open-minded to buy these books.
Yeah, you've brought me back to a very painful memory, I guess. When I started writing, I was living on an island in Japan, and I went online and I found the Gay Men's Press in the UK and ordered a couple of novels to be sent to me in Japan, forgetting that although I was in Japan, I had a New Zealand credit card, and my credit card bill was sent to my very Christian mother, who opened it to check, you know, what my that I was keeping up to date with everything. And I was so terrified at the thought of her opening this bill and seeing Gay Man's Press there amongst my purchases. It turned out okay for me.
I'm glad.
I called my stepdad and was like, John, you have to intercept my credit card statements. This is why. And John was like, you know, we love you. You know, your mom loves you, right? You can't do anything that will change that. So I was incredibly fortunate, but you know, the panic I felt, it's, yeah, as much as I have problems with Amazon, it's so good to know that we have the options to find books without going through that panic, really.
And there were many people that would had difficulty going into, first off, the gay stores were in gay neighborhoods, and there were lots of hurdles to overcome to feel comfortable going into these stores, feeling like it was that you belonged there. And eventually people did, but nowadays we don't, you know, require that.
Yeah. So this feels like a really abrupt transition, but Joel, what are the biggest changes you've seen in your time in audiobook production?
It's an interesting question. I've been at this about 7 years. You know, the lucky thing for us is that the audiobook industry grows exponentially every year. I mean, the growth is ridiculous. And so that bodes very well for us. The big kind of scary thing that people are freaked out about on the horizon is as AI, you know, as artificial intelligence becomes more and more realistic sounding, you know, people are concerned that, you know, AI will take over our jobs. But if that's going to happen, it's going to happen primarily on very backlist titles that are mostly nonfiction. And even though nonfiction is some of the toughest acting you'll have to do as a narrator, people don't realize that, publishers may not appreciate it, and they may sort of let a robotic voice do it. But for people like me, who are luckily, you know, actors and pride themselves on, you know, playing the nuance in text and subtext and doing many voices and dialects and things like that, it's not that much of a concern. What has definitely changed, especially with whatever the fuck it is, my brain is not working. You know what I mean? What has definitely changed is the casting mentality. On one hand, on the positive side, if it is a queer if it is written by a queer author, the chances are that the big five publishers will hire a queer narrator to do it, which is a definite step in the right direction. Now, male-male romance is a whole different thing and a whole different conversation. That is still very much there is a definite sort of I'll use the word titillation or appeal to having straight men do that, and there is not a that line has not yet been drawn, and I do understand that. If you want me to go into it, I can. But what is also happening, definitely in the audiobook industry, is if there is any kind of a marginalized voice represented in a book, any kind of minority, someone who is trans, even non-binary now, they will tend to look very specifically to cast that voice authentically. And narrators now are starting to guide authors in a way where they will be much more cautious about taking a book. You know, about 4 years ago, if there was a supporting African-American, like first person, the issue is first person, not playing characters within a third person story, because we have to play all the characters in a book, obviously. But like, let's say it's a first person story or first person alternating, which I have to do like two voices, their sides of the story alternating chapters. I would accept something that was like, you know, a mixed person or whatever, and a white person that go back and forth. And now I'm much more conscious about that. But certainly the publishers will find, and trans stories. I used to get hired to do a number of trans male stories, not trans female, but trans male stories. And now they will look for an authentic voice, which I think is great. So those are the big things I think I've noticed. But yeah, the growth is kind of incredible.
That is super exciting. Yeah. That just sounds like it's positive momentum in the right ways, which is incredibly heartening right now. So let's see. I'm just trying to decide whether we go with Valerie's question. In fact, I think we will. Valerie asks, do you have any advice for people publishing queer books that don't include any romance? Are there good landing places for that, or is it just the same as mainstream for the genre? So given that we are a rainbow space magic panel, I guess we're looking at this question with a sci-fi fantasy lens. So yeah, advice for people publishing queer books that don't include any romance.
So any number of publishers, large and small, should take such books. I think that often there are books that are primarily romantic stories with other elements, maybe fantastical or mystery or et cetera. And then there are books that are a literary novel, but may have some romantic elements to it. They're not necessarily totally a divergent path that these books have to take. Good stories usually are about people in situations, and people tend to have interpersonal relationships that sometimes spark romance. I think that the books that I've published and stories that I've written are not primarily romantic fiction. And I think that there's larger presses like Tor.com. There are books like Lee Mandello's Summer Suns, which no one would say is a romance. They would say it is a dark fantasy that happens to have romantic elements because, a ghost of an ex and things like that. But I think that your goal would be to look at the list as a writer. Your duty to your project is to look at who published books that you like and are somewhat similar to what you're writing about, in terms of it has this much romantic elements, it has this much horror, this much science fiction. And so what company do you see yourself as being a good fit for your book? And then find out how you can approach them. Do you need an agent? Sometimes the agent will know where to submit your books. And so there are things you can do. There's a home for your book.
As somebody who have started writing books with less and less romance in it and more paranormal and sort of mystery elements in them, I've found that it helps to be extremely explicit in my blurb that this story has romantic elements, but it's not a romance, and just really make sure that the reader knows what they're getting. And because I self-publish, I also try and make sure that I'm putting my book in the in an appropriate category on Amazon, and that my keywords are really reflective of my story and not reflective of what, you know, I think people might buy. Unhappy readers do not buy more books, and the goal is always that the reader has a great experience and goes on to buy further books. Joel, to kind of take advantage of your experience, have you produced any queer books that didn't include any romance? And what was sort of your impressions of sort of the marketing side of those books, if you have any?
I have not. Have I done any of those independently? I don't think I've done any indie titles like that. I've certainly done publisher titles like that. And I will say it is probably easier in that ilk. And I'm not saying this, I'm not saying that people shouldn't do it or write what their heart tells them to, but I would say that in the current publisher climate, it is probably easier for you if you are a queer writer trying to tell a queer story, to gain attention or traction with that kind of material. And maybe I'm wrong. I would say in terms of being an indie author, really pay attention to your cover. Your cover will tell people so much, guide them, you know, and will tell its own story and can guide them to understand the kind of story you're trying to tell and not tell, if that makes sense. I haven't had a lot of experience doing it with indie titles. So.
Yeah, awesome. Thank you for that. So we're going to move on to sort of the more...
Oh, you know what technical. I will add? Oh. Sorry, you know what I will
yes,
add?
Yes, go for it.
Sorry. What I will add is if you are trying to get your book done, if you're looking to doing the book that you've written of that ilk in audio, get yourself a narrator with a following, and they may well be a romantic following. But you know, the queer audio listening audience and the romance listening audience in particular, unlike almost any other aspect of audio, they follow narrators. They will buy a book because of the narrator. They can move the dial for you. So if you're worried your book doesn't tick all the boxes of what most people normally are looking at directly for, you know, the easy path, if you get attached to one of those heavy hitter queer narrators, or queer material narrators, I should say, then it can really help your book find people where it might normally get lost in a search on Amazon, if that makes sense.
Makes a lot of sense. Thank you. So, yeah, as I said, moving on to the technical side of things, Steve, what advice would you give to authors about how to get the best out of their relationship with a publisher?
Sure. You know, the publisher, it would be nice if we were all friends with our publishers, and I do have some authors that I am friendly with or that I would consider close friends, but it is a business relationship. You would like a publisher that responds in a reasonable amount of time. Lots of the smaller press publishers, this is not their day job. I myself work for a boarding school, you know, during the day. So, and if they, a lot of times they are also writers themselves. So it is more than a hobby, less than a career for many small presses. And even larger presses, unfortunately, are less communicative than others. So, but that said, the publisher should respond to you. You would like a publisher that will go to bat with you on reviews. I'm amazed how many books and authors do not try to get their books in Publishers Weekly, Library Journal, School Library Journal, Kirkus Reviews. If you think about how many copies of your book you would sell to libraries, that is a hefty amount. And some for your publisher should be able to at least say, I'm going to submit the book to Publishers Weekly. It costs nothing for a publisher to do this. Authors, sure, I understand. It could be several hundred. And if you are a prominent author for your publisher, then they should also spend the money that it costs to submit to Kirkus. Again, when I submit to Library Journal, there is no cost to me. It is simply sending out PDFs or print copies. You should find out how much money your publisher is spending on your cover. I'm not saying that you can demand a lot of money, but you should at least know, are they just simply spending $100 to get someone to do stock art? Or are they paying for original art, and is it like 300, 600? These are things you should know. You should always make sure that you have at least a decent discount to buy books yourself, because at the end of the day, you can always count on you promoting yourself. And so if you can't buy your own book for 40 to 50% off, then there's something really wrong here on this. And I think you should also be mindful that if I am having to jump ship to a new publisher on every book, something is going on. Am I being difficult to work with? My expectations are not being met? Are my expectations too high? Publishers do talk to each other. They really do. And I myself, if someone submitted a book and I find out that they've been in 5 different publishing companies, it's one thing if publishing companies close an orphan, but and hopefully you will have a good relationship. You may not be drinking buddies, but there's a mutual interest. The publisher wants you to succeed. They're not gonna sabotage your book, and you want the publisher to succeed because that helps you. Yep. I think you're muted.
You're muted, Gillian. There we go.
I did mute myself. Sorry about that. Before we leave you, Steve, can I just ask about working with editors? Because I know that for a lot of first-time authors especially, that has a lot of fear attached to it, because often it is the first time that someone has really critically appraised their work. So do you have any advice on how to deal with what can sometimes be very emotionally fraught?
Sure. It can be very intimidating. And it also is often for people who choose self-publishing, which I'm not saying is a wrong choice in any way, but one of the primary reasons is because they feel that their vision and style and craft will not be appreciated by another editor who will try to turn it into something else. And again, a good editor should always be trying to make your book be the best book can be. And also in that point, they should be distilling, like, I want to create the best Steve Berman book, not just best gay horror novel, but the best Steve Berman book. And so I see what you're doing there. The editor should be, you know, shoring up your sentences, checking for continuity errors, bringing out plot questions. It should not be a hatchet job. It should not be an attack on the person. I think that it's always good if you can to prepare yourself, but you know, it's unfortunately, it's like dating. You have to make yourself a little vulnerable, but much like arguably for some dating, the risk is worth it. But yes, definitely the editor should not leave you in tears and make you feel like you've been gutted.
Yep. I would definitely agree with that. And I would just like to say to anyone who's thinking of self-publishing as a way to avoid working with an editor, editors will help you improve your writing so much. And as a self-published, when I self-publish, I still go through the editing process because I know an editor can make my books so much better than I ever could alone. So self-publishing is not a way to avoid it.
Right. There,
if you
let me just, I see some people post it in the chats. Indies can't always afford us. They charge us and it's fairly steep. Well, I don't know. Publishers Weekly never charges me. I don't think that they shouldn't be charging anyone for, you can submit it. Doesn't mean that, by the way, when you submit a book to Publishers Weekly, to any review source, they don't have to review it. And I also realized, yes, you can pay for it. My thing is if the publishing company doesn't think you're worth $200 or $400 to invest in your book, you might want to ask, well, why are you publishing my book? And secondly, yes, I know that lots of people say about the Kirkus review, you know what happens? Publishers Weekly will take self-published. That one you have to pay for. Yes, for Kirkus, I will say that I've had a number of my authors have had starred reviews in Kirkus. I know for a fact that library sales have been bumped up by a Kirkus review. I think that it also helps. It helps on a certain professional level. Yes, maybe your average person looking for a good book may not care that your book got a great review in Kirkus, but certainly, if you're presenting your book to the same publisher or the next, then you're like, I got a great review here. Let's put this on. It does help the career. No review other than New York Times is going to guarantee success. Just like no blurb other than maybe, you know, Stephen King or that level is going to shoot you up there. But these are things that can be done. And self-publishing, for self-publishing people, I know it seems a little skeevy to think about paying for a review, but oftentimes self-published people do pay for their own cover. They're going to pay for an audiobook. They're going to pay for editing. And so it's not a bad idea to think, can I also budget $425 for Kirkus? Because if Kirkus raves about it, then if you do decide that you want to go with a traditional publishing method, that's going to help you.
Awesome. It is good to have that perspective. It's not one that I think indie authors hear very often. So it's very definitely a great one to have. We're going to jump over to Joel now. Joel, how would you recommend authors have the best possible experience producing an audiobook with a narrator?
I want to talk about both things Steve addressed.
Okay.
In terms of an editor, if at all you can, as an indie author, spend the money, if you can. If not, if you absolutely cannot, and even if you were able to, read your book out loud before you send it to print, because you will find things no one before you found. You will also find sentences that rhyme, so your book out loud doesn't sound like Dr. Seuss. You will find things that are problematic in a mouse, but mostly you're going to find mistakes that everyone else's eyes went over. I just did a absolutely wonderful book where someone took their pants off twice during a sex scene. You need that outside eye, or at least if you're reading it out loud, you're going to find things because your eye's not scanning. The other thing I would say is have someone very specifically who identifies in the world you're writing, be it a gay male, be it a trans female, whatever, a non-binary person, find someone and ask them to read it for you and tell you the truth. I have narrated gay sex scenes that honestly were implausible and downright painful. It is not the same as a vagina. And no matter how much cocky boys porn you watch, you're not going to understand how it really feels or the mechanics. Have someone who does read that for you if you're not of that ilk. Now, in terms of publishing, there's a lot to say about this. First thing is, a lot of indie authors are going to try and go to ACX under a royalty share contract, meaning they split what Amazon gives you as 40% of the royalties. So you are taking 20% of the royalties and sharing that with the narrator. So you get 20, they get 20, which means you're going to make about $2 per book. If you are paying outright for the audio, you'll make about $4 per book. That's the average. Now, if you are doing that royalty share aspect, you need to be aware, first of all, you're going to get a less experienced, I'm not going to say less talented, but on average, you're going to get a less experienced caliber of narrator. That narrator is much less likely to move the dial for you in terms of audience and viewership if you are trying to make a foray into audio and you don't have a knowledge of the audience, doesn't know you. If you are going to do royalty share, It is very different timing-wise than doing it pay what we call pay per hour, where you just pay me a fee, I do the audio, and it's yours. If you're doing it royalty share, we are looking at things. We are looking at your cover. We are looking at the number of Amazon reviews you have, the number of Goodreads reviews you have. We're looking at your previous books and how many reviews those have received. So the thing is, it may not be the smartest idea, unless it's a series. Okay, if it's a series, you've already got that audience built in. And one other thing I'll tell you is, financially, you can always count on a series that you will sell half the number of books you sold for the first book. That is how it goes. I've done 450 books. I've done a lot of series. I've watched this happen, right? So if you sell 250, if you get 250 Audible reviews with your first book, you're going to get half that for your next book. So you need to plan on that economically. Sometimes saying to yourself, I'm going to write a 7-book series, is never going to end up financially tenable for you in audio. So we are shopping for you as much as you're shopping for us when you're doing a royalty share project. You need to show us that you can write all this stuff in the audition material. You can say that, you can say what your marketing plan is. You can say how many Twitter followers you have. Say how many TikTok followers you have. Say what your plan is going to be. Because then royalty share is much trickier. So sometimes you need to wait a while so the book has gained some traction in print for us to see that it's worth taking the gamble in audio to join you in a royalty share contract. If you are paying outright, the sooner you can get that book released simultaneously, the more money you're going to make. And you can do that now with Audible. You didn't used to be able to, but with ACX, you can do a simultaneous release. And if you're willing to pay my fee and pay me up front, the sooner you can get it released simultaneously, the more sales you're going to see from that. Also, it means you're spending your money on your marketing simultaneously. You're not having to do a whole other marketing push when the audiobook comes out. When you are auditioning, you want to tell us what you want to hear. Don't just put your 5-minute sample. Don't just pick the first 5 minutes of the book for us to audition, because that may not have the character voices you're interested in. And then tell us what you want to hear in those voices. Say, it's a Morgan Freeman type. I want a Ryan Reynolds energy. I hear Scarlett Johansson doing this. It will help us get in your head and find what you want and get on the same page with you. And then don't forget to tell us where your book is set. We can't read the whole damn thing. And if your book is set in Louisiana and it doesn't say that in the first 5 pages, we don't know. You would also, there's a place for accent, and you'd be amazed the number of authors that literally click not specified. I need to know what voice you want. I need to know if you'll accept that your fantasy novel as a British narration, which I recommend for fantasy, by the way, not sci-fi necessarily, but fantasy. But I want to know if I need to be doing a Texas accent for you. And 95% of the time, no, that's not fair. 80% of the time, if the book is set in America, you'd be amazed how many times they never tell you where the book is set. They'll never say you're in Ohio or Omaha or Michigan. They just won't tell you. And I need to know that to bring your book to life. Once you're working with your narrator, send them the information up front. We cannot read your mind. We want to know how to help you. And no narrator is ever going to resent you giving them. I ask my authors to fill out a character sheet. I ask them age, level of education, where they're from, where they've spent the most time, what their patronus would be, because if I know a character is an owl versus a snake versus a meerkat, that helps me understand your version of them. I ask them a whole series of questions, and you can give them that stuff and they'll be thrilled. And then we want to get in your head. We want to give you the movie that existed in your mind. You can do the same thing with a publisher. Here is the thing with publishers. we are not allowed direct contact. I can't email you. I am told specifically not to email you on Twitter and go, hey, I wondered what Susanna was like. Can you tell me how you vocally think of her? We're not allowed to. But you can give, you can send that to the publisher and they will always, always forward it to your narrator. And the sooner you get it to them, because you may not know when they're recording, once you sign your contract, sit down, get that stuff done, and send it out there. Send it to the publisher, and they will share it with us. It makes such a difference and makes me so much less stressed. Like, you can't believe how much you the more shit you send me, the better you're going to like what I do, and the more comfortable I'm going to be and feel confident. Also, I'm sorry, I'm rambling. There's a lot to say, and I'm trying to get it out quick. If you, one thing your editor should catch if they don't, and if you do, or if you read it out loud, you will. If you describe a character on page 300, it is too late. If we meet your character on page 5, describe them that way. First of all, that's how we think if I'm telling you a story. But also, your reader has already crafted in their mind an image and what that character sounds like in their mind. And if you suddenly say on page 300, he said in his rough Cockney accent, they're totally torn out of the story because their vision doesn't match your vision. So if you've got descriptors in your book, make sure you front load them when we meet the character if you can. Also, if you're writing a series, and they do these, and gay authors love to do these branching series where you'll meet a couple and then the next book will be about the couple's mailman, and then the next book will be about the mailman's cousin, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. If you introduce them in the first book and you know they're going to become a romantic lead or any kind of a lead in book 4, describe that character as soon as you can. Because if I don't have that info, I'm going to make a choice. And once I've made that choice for the first 3 books, if I get to book 4, especially, I can't go back and fix it. I can't redo the voice. But what's going to happen is if you suddenly say, you know, she said in her lilting New Zealand tones, I have to do that accent, and the listener is going to be really pissed off at me. One other thing, and I'll shut up. If you imagine your characters having accents, try and put that on the page. I have done 2 very extreme, very, very lengthy series, like 5 and 6 books, where the author wanted Israeli, Greek, Italian, Russian, French for the characters, and they never put it on the page. And the listeners think I'm fucking insane. They think I'm just randomly spinning a wheel and going, I think this guy's gonna sound like this, and going rogue and not respecting the author's words necessarily. So if you hear that, put it on the page if you can. You're helping your narrator, you're helping your reader, you're helping your listener. I think that's it. Okay.
Wow. So comprehensive.
All those dialects sounds like the salad bar, you know, at where I work.
It's a lot. It's a lot.
Yep. Unfortunately, we are at the end of our panel. Valerie, apologies for not getting to your second question, but we might be able to answer that in the discussion following. But yeah, like Jennifer and Kristen, I was taking so many notes during that. I think both of you managed to answer 3 questions worth in that one question. So thank you so much. I think I speak for all of the audience when I say that we have learned a lot, we have taken many notes, and we've got a lot to think about. So yeah, thanks everyone for joining the Rainbow Space Magic. What are we? We're a kind of
panel-y thing,
thank you. Words, what are they? But yeah, we've had a really great discussion, and now I'm hoping that Monique is going to jump in with the information about how to hop over.
Real quick, can we tell you how to find us?
Yes.
Can we tell people how to find us? You can follow me on TikTok, where I actually do a series of narrators tips for authors, at Joel Leslie Froomkin, Froomkin. You can find me on Facebook at the same thing. You can find me on Twitter at Joel Leslie Fro. You can find my website by just searching for me. I think it's joelleslienarration.com. And I'm always happy to help authors that are looking to try and foray into audio. And it is worth the investment. You will find new listeners. You will find new readers. I promise you, it will be worth the time. Anyway, thank you. That's me.
And you can, I'm at steveberman.com. My Lethe Press is at lethepressbooks.com. We're probably on Lethe Press for Twitter, and I'm the real Steve Berman on Twitter, and always happy to talk about books. So.
Yep. I am also always happy to talk about books, and you can find me on Facebook as Gillian St. Kevern, or at my website, which is also gillianstkevern.com. Yay.